so much.
Well, thank you, Dennis and Laura, for that particularly warm introduction. It's actually my second visit to Kansas City this year, and I've enjoyed both of them very much. I am sorry to hear about the Royals, but I think maybe this weekend we can help cheer you all up by cataloging the tremendous destruction, devastation, and the great Armageddon of the First World War. Hopefully this will put everyone in a better mood. Well, so this subject is obviously one that I'm quite interested in. I've always been interested in it. I think, like a lot of Americans for whom maybe it's not necessarily our historical war of choice, I mean, other than here in Kansas City, I know you're a bit eccentric here, but for most Americans, it's not really the first kind of war of choice as far as historical buffs and young students discovering history and so on. Like a lot of Americans, I actually first discovered it by reading Barbara Tuchman's History of the Guns of August, which still sells quite briskly, as I notice every time I check my own sales figures on Amazon. It's a little bit frustrating to realize that you're still being outsold by a book written more than 50 years ago. So what I say about Tuchman, I say it with due respect because I was actually quite inspired by her book. I mean, to give her fair due, I'd say I've gotten at least three or four books out of the inspiration she provided me. So I'm quite fond of both that book and also Barbara Tuchman and even some of her essays on the practice of history, another book of which I'm quite fond. All that said, I have to say there are a few problems with The Guns of August, as I've discovered over the years in my own research on the subject. Now, I think that her generation, it's not just her. I mean, you could look at a lot of the historians writing in the 60s, the height of the Cold War. You had A.G.P. Taylor on the British side writing about railway timetables and such. You had Fritz Fischer and his acolytes in Germany writing about not only mobilization plans, but generally speaking, kind of large designs, these plans that were almost kind of set in stone, German premeditation of the war, this war that was somehow kind of fated to happen. You can understand what people were thinking about then. We're all creatures of our time, and at the height of the Cold War, particularly right before the Cuban Missile Crisis when Barbara Tuchman was writing, in fact, there's kind of an urban legend that her book was actually passed back and forth between Khrushchev and Kennedy. I think there's some oddities with that story. It supposedly happened, I think, at the Berlin summit, only the book didn't come out until a year later. So I'm not quite sure exactly what the real story was with Khrushchev and Kennedy, but you can see kind of what she's getting at. Military alliances were obviously all the rage in the Cold War. There were two rather enormous military alliances, the Warsaw Pact and NATO, which did seem to drive events. Arms race? Well, of course, you had the arms race of all arms races, the nuclear arms race, the height of the Cold War, eventually leading to this rather charming strategic doctrine known as mutually assured destruction. So you can see why someone would write about the First World War as she did by starting with the plans of the powers and the alliances and then skipping over the entire month of July before the war. That was the oddest thing when I reread her book after kind of learning about the subject. She actually skips over the month or month-odd 5 weeks in between the Sarajevo assassination of the 28th of June, 1914, and the outbreak of war in early August. She actually skips over Sarajevo. That was the other really astonishing thing that I learned when I read it. She gave a line to Sarajevo and about a paragraph to the July crisis. She also did something really interesting in her kind of introductory remarks at the beginning of the book. She basically told her readers up front that she would not be covering Serbia and Austria-Hungary in her book. She was worried about space, I suppose, and the dramatic structure of the thing, and she thought it would add undue length if she described the Balkans. Well, that too you could begin to understand if you're thinking about the early 1960s. The Balkans were kind of the back of beyond in the Cold War. They were behind the Iron Curtain and not really a whole lot talked about after the Tito-Stalin split, and even then they were not exactly a kind of hot zone. Much like that, even the Caucasus had kind of disappeared behind the Iron Curtain. Ethnic questions in general had kind of receded to the background. Even Turkey, my own home of long duration, had just disappeared to some extent from the story. I mean, most histories of the Cold War, you hear a bit about Turkey as a kind of bit player in the Cuban Missile Crisis. She loses her Jupiter missiles and, you know, gets a little bit hot and bothered, and that's about it. So you can see why the story is only about the great powers and mostly about the arms races and the alliances. I like to think that our own generation has had a couple of reminders, both of the importance of geography, and I also like to think the importance of contingency. You know, what Macmillan used to call events, my dear boy, events. You actually have to get into the nitty-gritty of the thing and understand those events. For my own generation, and probably even the millennials, I suppose, although some of them are too young, I suppose 9/11 will inevitably be the touchstone where everyone remembers where they were, the world before 9/11. Well, I think partly because of our rediscovery of the Balkans with the wars in the former Yugoslavia, our rediscovery of both history, religion, even something like terrorism, obviously, with 9/11, I like to think we have a better understanding now of what was really going on in 1914. Recent books don't paint the war as this inevitable thing which had to happen, that was fated somehow in the structure of the international system, the alliances between the powers, their war plans, the mobilization timetables. Important as all those were in the playing out of the story, they don't really explain why it happened. They don't really explain why Europe went so suddenly from total peace to total war in 1 month in 1914. One of the more interesting, although I think also not entirely satisfying books in recent years to come out on the origins of the war, was a book by David Frumpkin about 10 years ago. He's better known as the author of A Peace to End All Peace, a book with which I will soon be competing with my own history on the Ottoman War, which is actually a much better book, I think, than his book on the outbreak of the war itself, Europe's Last Summer, which came out in 2004. But he had a really interesting metaphor, which is quite striking. He said the war came to Europe a little bit like clear air turbulence, you know, on a calm flight, unexpected even by the pilots and some of the passengers because possibly the seatbelt signs weren't on. And this has actually happened from time to time in commercial aviation where suddenly everyone is just buffeted about the plane and those unlucky enough not to be wearing their seatbelts might find their heads bouncing off the ceiling. That, he said, was what happened in 1914, this sudden and total shock. And there is some interesting evidence for this. Among economic financial historians, Neil Ferguson has looked at things like the bond market. He says, well, there was no expectation of war. It wasn't priced in. Michael Nyberg, who I think you'll be hearing from tomorrow morning, I think, has written very eloquently about kind of ordinary people in Europe and their lives and how, in fact, the war came almost like this bolt from the blue, entirely unexpected. Maybe in some cases, like in Hitler's famously, it was not entirely unwelcome, but it was not expected. That is to say, it was not something that was kind of on people's horizons. And I think that's true. I do think, though, that Frumpkin's metaphor took things a bit too far. The war didn't come out of nowhere. The war did come from somewhere, both temporally and, of course, geographically. My own contention is it didn't come quite from the place that people thought that it did. So what I'd like to do, after 9/11, people used to talk about the world of 9/10, that is to say the world before 9/11 seemed to re-alter the geopolitical landscape. Everyone seems to remember that day, and it's true, no one was really expecting several planes to hit the World Trade Center and the Pentagon and one to crash in Pennsylvania. I don't think anyone was expecting that. I know I wasn't. I mean, I remember where I was. I'd watched Monday Night Football the night before. I think the day before I watched the US Open final, Pete Sampras got trounced by Leighton Hewitt. I remember the papers were talking about that and they were talking about shark attacks in Florida. And there was one really colossal scandal in the New York papers because I was actually in New York on 9/11. That was, it involved a Little League pitcher who had falsified his age documents. You know, he was 14 and he had been pitching in the 12 and unders. And that's what people were talking about. They certainly weren't talking about Islamic terrorism. They weren't talking about Osama bin Laden. They weren't talking about Peshawar in the northwest frontier in Pakistan. So what were people talking about on the 27th of June, 1914? Let's see if I can pull up the... There we are. What were people talking about? Well, if people were following current affairs at all, which admittedly not everyone was doing in 1914, but let's say the people who were actually reading the better newspapers, here's what they would have been talking about. They would have been talking about the Balkans. Now, if you looked at this part of the world of June 27th was not particularly peaceful. In fact, the world of June 27th, if we're going to go back even as little as 3 years, had seen no less than three wars, which might not have been great power wars, but they were certainly wars which impacted the lives of thousands, if not millions, of people. The first of those wars had embroiled Italy with the Ottoman Empire. It was a war something like, you might call it the reductio ad absurdum of either the high era of imperialism or colonialism. Essentially, the Italians put forth the claim, which went back to the Berlin Congress of the 1880s, which stipulated that certain powers were entitled to compensation if other powers made certain moves. Long story short, France sent some troops into Morocco, and so the Italians said, this gives us a right to send troops into Tripoli. Now, don't ask me why that gave them that right, but there was some kind of an odd legal pretext. But so, essentially, they invaded Tripoli, Libya, as we would call it today. And before long, the Ottomans had discovered, to their horror, that they actually had no way of getting troops there, because the Aegean Sea and basically the Eastern Mediterranean were now crisscrossed by Italian vessels, and the Ottomans did not have a fleet which could compete. So that even some of their top military officers, people like Enver Pasha, later Pasha, he was not Pasha yet, Mustafa Kemal, the later Ataturk, they actually had to get there essentially incognito. They had to travel in disguise as civilians and go in by way of British Egypt. It was an interesting war. It was actually the first modern war which saw the use of what we might call at least semi-strategic air power, dirigibles dropping bombs. There were a few naval skirmishes, but it was quite one-sided at sea. It was quite one-sided in Libya, although interestingly, the fighting, when the Italians tried to go inland beyond the coastal towns, they were bogged down. And the most savage fighting, and this is where Enver and Mustafa Kemal both cut their chops, was interestingly enough in the suburbs of Benghazi. So while that war was happening, meanwhile, several of the Balkan states were kind of licking their chops, temporarily setting aside their differences, those being the so-called Balkan League formed of Serbia, Bulgaria, Montenegro, and Greece. And they had all agreed, they hadn't agreed on everything. They hadn't agreed on who got every bit of Macedonia, but they had basically agreed to team up and attack the Ottoman Empire while she was in a war with Italy, basically piggybacking on the Italian conflict to get their revenge of centuries of humiliation and oppression by the Turks and so on. And they pounced quite quickly, and they actually won a victory which actually surprised a lot of people in Europe. Now, in the wake of this war, and here we're getting closer to where we stood on June 27th, in the wake of this war, and then a brief reprise of that conflict, the Second Balkan War, which broke out in 1913. Now, as you might imagine, partly because of the successful aggression of these Balkan states, there was a massive wave of refugees pouring into the Ottoman Empire, mostly Muslims. Now, it is true that some Christians were fleeing in the other directions, but for the most part, because the Serbians are pushing down south, the Bulgarians actually tried to push here, which turned out to be a little bit of a mistake because Greece and Serbia then teamed up against them and basically kept them out of Macedonia. All of the gains of these powers, of course, came at the expense not only of the Ottoman army but of many of the local Muslims who began fleeing in colossal numbers into Turkey. If you looked at Constantinople, Istanbul itself, that basically turned into a refugee camp. The Hagia Sophia, or Hagia Sophia, which may or may not soon be turned back into a mosque by the regime of Erdogan, had become essentially a cholera infirmary. These refugees are pouring into Turkey. Now, the problem of any refugee crisis, there are immense problems. It's not simply about how you care for, if you can, these refugees. It's also where you put them. And so the Turks were trying to figure out where to put several hundred thousand of these Turks pouring in. And one of the places they decided they would begin to put them was down here on the Aegean coast. This is actually where a lot of the refugees, the kind of refuge of the Balkans, they end up being dumped. I actually have some personal experience of this. My wife and her family, they're actually Turkish refugees from Bulgaria who ended up in Bursa. Now, in this case, many of them are going as far south as Smyrna. Some of them are up about here. Now, the problem with this is that this region in Turkey was actually pretty heavily Greek, Orthodox Christian. And so many of these Greeks are not only now being persecuted to some extent by way of kind of revenge for what has been done to the Muslims of the Balkans, many of them are actually getting forced out of their homes in part to make way for the new arrivals. And so you have this ethnic explosion building right here in Western Anatolia. And here's where things stood on June 27th. The clock was ticking. The Third Balkan War was about to break out between Turkey and Greece. Athens had sent an ultimatum. Essentially, you must stop this maltreatment of the Greeks of Anatolia, to which the Turkish government, of course, replied, "We're doing all that we can, but you can hardly blame our Muslims, you know, for believing as they do or behaving as they do, considering all of them have just been expelled from their homes in the Balkans." Everyone is expecting a new round of ethnic cleansing to break out. And most of all, and here's the most interesting thing I discovered, the reason the clock was ticking was because of a naval race. It was not between Britain and Germany, the naval race which occupies several acres of books on the shelf. There's a great book by Robert Massey on this subject. He has a wonderful one-word title, Dreadnought. You know, and his book, of course, is about this inexorable buildup of tensions between Britain and Germany. The problem is it's not actually true. And if you look at it, there had been a really intense naval race between around 1906 and about 1910, and then it sort of petered off and then basically stopped around 1911 because the British were winning and the Germans had pretty much given up and no one was really talking about it. There was, however, a naval race here. The Ottomans had discovered that they had no way, not simply of getting troops to North Africa to fight Italy. They discovered in the Balkan Wars they couldn't even ferry troops across the Aegean because the Greeks had naval superiority. And so the Ottomans had placed orders for dreadnoughts. The first of those dreadnoughts was expected to arrive in July 1914, built, of course, in British shipyards. So the Greeks were basically, and the Russians are watching this too, the Russians themselves are terrified of the arrival of the Greek dreadnought. But the other thing which terrifies the Russians is that in the course of the war with Italy, the Ottomans had actually closed the straits here, thus cutting off Russia from essentially her only warm water access to world markets. The Russians, however, do not want a new war between Greece and Turkey because the last war had given the Turks a pretext to close the straits. So the Russians are desperately trying to stave off this war. That's the interesting part here, is that the expectation, you know, a betting man or someone who was, let's say, trying to read the tea leaves in the bond market would have been expecting a war to break out shortly between Greece and the Ottoman Empire. A war which, however, may not necessarily have spread. Because, first of all, the powers had no interest in this. The only one who had a direct interest was Russia, and Russia did not want the war to happen. The other powers are looking at this, and, well, they're seeing yet another possible catastrophe, which they hope will not embroil the powers. But they had recent experience of dealing with it. A London conference had convened in the course of the First Balkan War. Basically, almost the entire length of the First Balkan War had gone alongside this conference in London. And the powers had done what they could. Basically, they ganged up, of course, against the Turks, but for the most part, they had adjudicated a settlement which worked more or less well, although, the revisionist powers then fought the Second Balkan War. But the precedent was there. Possibly a new London conference. Possibly the powers might even have recoiled in mutual horror at a new round of ethnic cleansing in the Balkans. So this, then, is what I think was the most likely scenario as everyone woke up on the morning of the 28th of June, 1914. Possibly a war to be breaking out in the Balkans, the Third Balkan War, a war which, however, might well have put all diplomats on high alert. They were already on high alert. They may have convened a conference, and the world then would have, you know, kind of teetered along its way. See if I can get to the next slide. There we are. So here we are on the 28th of June, 1914. No one is expecting, of course, this day to be terrifically different from the last, least of all Franz Ferdinand. You know, gets up in his hotel, Hotel Ilija. It's actually still, the Hotel Bosnia in Ilija outside Sarajevo. It's actually still there, believe it or not. He gets up, you know, dashes off a note to his children. They had just deposited their children in this little resort town in today's modern Czechoslovakia. You know, Papi and Mommy can't wait to see you on Tuesday. You know, it's a Sunday morning. He attends service in a chapel. You know, he and his wife, they get all kind of dolled up, dressed up for the royal progress they're about to make through Sarajevo. And, of course, they weren't expecting that there were seven assassins lined up along the quay waiting for them. Now, what's interesting about the conspiracy, and here's the thing, a lot of people are actually quite dismissive of conspiracies, what they call conspiracy theories. But if you actually look closely at history, they're all over the place. Now, they may not necessarily be secretive. You know, it may not necessarily be the Knights of, you know, the Round Table and the kind of the Dan Brown world of, whatever he called it, you know, the Illuminati. But, I mean, this was actually a pretty open conspiracy. The Black Hand was, well, it was sort of kind of known by intelligence officers. It wasn't as well known as the Narodna Odbrana, the kind of the larger Serbian League of the National Defense. It was known there were plots. It was known there were assassins. It was known there were all these kind of secret handshakes in the Balkans. I mean, the Young Turks in Turkey had come out of a similar secret society. You know, so all that was known. It was known that this was possibly risky, you know, this trip. And in fact, on Franz Ferdinand's previous royal progress, they had actually lined the streets, this was to Romania, they had actually lined the streets with a much heavier security cordon. Franz Ferdinand hadn't liked that so much. You know, he liked for his subjects to see him, and so he actually requested a lighter security cordon. The thing was quite well advertised. In fact, oddly enough, 2 days before, he had actually gone through the street bazaars of Sarajevo, you know, just basically mingling among the people, and of course, nothing had happened. Unfortunately, this time, of course, there were seven assassins lined up on the quay, three of whom had been trained and armed back in Belgrade, as we know today, by this kind of conspiracy of officers in the Black Hand, of which the leading one was Apis Dragutin Dmitrievich. Dmitrievich, interestingly, left a confession a few years later. There was sort of a last will and testament of the assassin Princip, too. You know, and when they asked Princip if he had any regrets, you know, he was dying in prison. They're administering last rites, you know, regrets about helping to unleash this bloodbath, Armageddon of World War. And he said, no, if I hadn't done it, the Germans would have found some other excuse. He was kind of an early proponent of the war guilt school. Interestingly, Dmitrievich, in his own confession, shortly before he was executed for another crime, he had a lot of blood on his hands. You know, he had been personally involved in the assassination of the king and queen back in 1903. He also murdered a crown prince a little bit later, and that's why he was about to be executed. Well, anyway, his last will and testament, he put down in paper that, yes, he had organized the conspiracy. He also said, and it's interesting that everyone remembers this part of his confession, but not the second. He also said that the Russians had given him a green light, and he said that they had given him funds. Now, we don't know why he said that. We don't know whether it's true. We do know, however, that there was a conspiracy and that there were seven assassins. So does that mean it was fated to happen? Well, not necessarily. I mean, they did have the street blanketed pretty nicely, as you can see by these numbers here. Did it have to happen? Well, something was going to happen, surely. We all know that terrorists sometimes pull off the big one. Oftentimes, they fail. In this case, only three of the assassins had actually been given proper training. The others had been recruited locally. The seventh and last, although oddly enough, he was actually given the first position, which made no sense. You can actually tell by his name, Mehmet Bashic. He was a Muslim. He had been recruited as window dressing. You know, to throw investigators off the scene of the crime so they wouldn't notice that the other six were all Serbian nationals, even if they were, of course, subjects of Austria-Hungary, and thus Serbia had plausible deniability. Well, the first two basically did nothing. They just kind of stood there on their hands, you know, as the car is winding its way down the Royal Progress, down the Miljeka River, along the Apple Quay. The third assassin, Shabrinovic, and he was the first assassin lined up there who had actually received his training. Well, he did actually act. He didn't have a pistol. He had a fuse bomb. And so, you know, he lit the fuse, you know, he readied, he aimed, he fired, he threw. And he threw it right at the Archduke's car, and he actually hit Archduke Franz Ferdinand in the cheek. And he actually bruised him, you know, seriously, not severely, but seriously. And it then, you know, kind of grazed off and detonated behind the car right behind him. And there were several more serious injuries. There was a military officer called Lieutenant Colonel Morizzi in the kind of the staff entourage who had to be taken to the hospital. A couple of bystanders were injured, but luckily there were no fatalities, and the Archduke and his wife, though shaken up and slightly bruised, were both fine. And so they proceeded on with the program, and the Archduke was not assassinated, and the Third Balkan War broke out between Greece and Turkey, which was endowed by the powers, and the 20th century hurled on an uncertain course. Except that didn't happen. No, what did actually happen, oddly enough, is they did continue on, and they went to town hall, and they gave a bunch of rather boring pre-prepared speeches, you know, platitudes. My own favorite part of this story is when the mayor, who's a Muslim, Fahim Effendi, is, you know, he's reading out the speech he had prepared, And so, you know, he's giving these kind of pro forma remarks. You know, as you can see, welcome to Sarajevo. We're so grateful to have you. As you can see, the people of Sarajevo, you know, are very, very fond of you. And you know, what are you talking about? They just threw a bomb at me. You know, by this part, he's getting a little bit kind of pissy, you know, and they're not really quite sure what to do next. The program, the original program, they're actually supposed to go back down, retrace their footsteps, then turn here, and then go on to the museum. There was an alternative plan, considering they had just had an assassination attempt, to call off the risky part of the plan, because this Franz Josef Strasse was quite narrow here. So the other idea was, they would make a left turn at the Kaiser Bridge, going through the Muslim quarter, seen as much safer than the Serbian neighborhoods. They would just go to lunch, basically. I mean, why not? You know, just go to lunch and get out of Dodge. And that was probably the most sensible plan. That plan was vetoed by one man, and one man alone. And that was the Archduke Franz Ferdinand. Not because he was desperate to see the antiquities at the museum. No, because he was an honorable man and he wanted to go visit the wounded military officer at the garrison hospital, which unfortunately, by a random coincidence, happened located basically in the same quarter of the town as the museum, meaning they would proceed along essentially the same route as formerly. Now, this still should have been okay, because now they were on the lookout for assassins. And so they had basically reconfigured the motorcade, and the plan was, you know, to avoid the Franz Josef Strasse, to hit full speed coming down here, and then, you know, go in by a different route that wouldn't be expected by the assassins. And meanwhile, the trouble spot where all the assassins seemed to be, so far as they knew, there was only one, but they figured there might have been more somewhere along here. The first bomb had been thrown by the riverside, which was the left side, and so they actually put a bodyguard in the left side of the car, on the running board. It was one of those old-fashioned cars, you know, that had a running board, and so he was there to guard from the left. So it should have been fine. Essentially, the plan was that by the time they got down close to the Lateiner Bridge, they should have been reaching full cruising speed. You know, in kind of stick shift terms, you'd probably be like shifting into fourth gear. You know, and maybe hitting, I suppose in that area, you'd probably be hitting about, you know, 40 or 50 miles per hour if you're really lucky. Probably not quite that fast because they're in an urban area. At that speed, getting off a kill shot would have been virtually impossible. Now, it is true that had they turned here at the Kaiser Bridge, they would have been dealing with Grabesch, but of course, he was just on a single corner of the bridge. So it's possible he might have gotten off a shot. But even he would have been shooting at a moving target. Now, none of these men were exactly Marine snipers. Gavrilo Princip had some military training, and apparently it was probably good enough. But he had actually tried to join the military back in the Balkan Wars, you know, tried to volunteer to fight for Serbia. They had rejected him. You know, he had basically washed out of training after a couple of days because he was too weak and sickly. So he's not exactly a crack sniper. Now, as things turned out, when they got down to about here, instead of accelerating and hitting fourth gear, the first car kind of activated the clutch, hit the brakes, made a right turn, because that was, after all, the original plan. Now, it's still unclear to this day whether he just forgot or whether the military governor, Paciorek, forgot to tell him. We don't know for sure why this happened. We do know, though, that it happened, that the second car followed him, that the third car followed him. The third car, of course, is the one in which the Archduke, his wife, Paciorek, were traveling. This third car made the turn, but the third car is the first where there were people in the car who realized it was a wrong turn, and they barked at the driver to turn around. He struggled a little bit with the clutch, trying to get the car into reverse. And so the car stood there motionless for, you know, probably well on 5, 6, 7, 8, maybe 9 seconds. And that was enough for Gavrilo Princip to alter the course of world history. So I think anyway with his shots. Now, why did it matter? This thing is really a little bit slow. There we go. Why did it matter? Well, if you look at the great powers of Europe, and this is really just kind of an Eastern Europe map, that's because that is, after all, where the crisis is originating. Now, obviously, this crisis is going to redound much more dramatically in Austria-Hungary than any of the other powers. Austria-Hungary, after all, has just annexed Bosnia-Herzegovina. That's why, incidentally, the Black Hand and Narodna Odbrana had been formed to basically overturn this annexation. Put through finally in 1908, even though the Austrians had been there since the 1870s. Belgrade is actually the Serbian capital, is located literally on the Austro-Hungarian border. And so you have immediately a security crisis for Austria-Hungary. not to mention the fact that everyone's blood is up because not just the heir to the throne. The other thing to remember about Franz Ferdinand, now he wasn't simply the heir to the throne. The actual Emperor Franz Joseph was an octogenarian who was not expected to live much longer. He had actually just gone through a kind of protracted illness. It was said by some that the only reason he had recovered was because he wanted to spite his nephew, because he knew his nephew had been waiting for 30 years to become emperor. And they were terrifically unfond of each other. Franz Ferdinand had, of course, married famously, if not a commoner. He had married a noble woman who was not of sufficiently high rank to meet Habsburg standards of royal protocol. And so their children had actually been, essentially cut out from the royal succession, that is, forbidden from ascending to the throne themselves. So there was bad blood between the two of them. So the emperor was not, shall we say, entirely unhappy with the news that Franz Ferdinand had been killed. However, I think his reaction was colored more, of course, by the shock and the anger and the offense caused by the Serbs. So Franz Ferdinand, he was not simply the heir to the throne. He had his own government that he was running from Belvedere Palace. He was largely already responsible for military affairs. The army, the common army, was essentially his bailiwick. So he was an important man. It was not nobody that had been assassinated. The equivalent in, let's say, I don't know, modern American terms would have been not necessarily the vice president, but somebody, possibly chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, possibly someone higher up like the Speaker of the House, third in line for the presidency, someone of that nature. In other words, a very important policymaker and by no means a figurehead had just been assassinated. So obviously the Austrians are not going to do nothing. Everyone is expecting them to act, and no one knows exactly what that act will be. It didn't necessarily have to lead to war. One of the really interesting things about the story of the July crisis when you look at the Austro-Hungarian side is that in a curious way, the most hot-headed policymakers, people like Konrad von Hutzendorf, chief of army staff, the equivalent of Moltke, Moltke the Younger, usually called in Berlin, is quite famously belligerent. He had been arguing for years that Austria needed to deal with Serbia. It was said he had advocated going to war with Serbia something like 25 times in 1913 alone. But everyone knew what he thought. He wasn't really the wild card. His policy line, though, that is a kind of a short, sharp strike, might not necessarily have led to a larger conflagration. That is, the powers would have been hard-pressed to react so quickly. Unfortunately, nothing really happened quickly in the dual monarchy of Austria-Hungary, least of all in the army, which had developed a reputation for, if not grotesque impotence, then something approaching it, not simply because it had sat out the Balkan Wars, even though many people were expecting Austria to intervene, but among other things, a Colonel Radel had actually sold a copy of the mobilization plan to the Russians. He had also sold, interestingly enough, copies of at least bits and pieces of the German mobilization plan to the Russians. He had then committed suicide, as the story would go. I don't actually know the details, so I can't tell you definitively what exactly actually happened. But we do know that the story, the extent that is of the scandal, was hushed up. So it was probably actually much deeper than people thought. So the Austrians were kind of seen as incompetent. And they were. That was the real problem. Among other things, when Konrad is talking about immediate mobilization, for whatever reason, he did not block the decision to send most of the army on harvest leave in July. Now, many historians, that is, they're going home to help with the harvest, many historians put a kind of Machiavellian interpretation on this, saying, well, this was a way of kind of pulling the wool over the eyes of other diplomats, that Austria-Hungary was pretending like it wasn't actually going to do anything. I'm not quite sure if I understand this interpretation, that Austria-Hungary, by hamstringing its own military and making it impossible to move before August in response to an assassination which happened in late June, I'm not sure if this necessarily indicates competence, much less the kind of Machiavellian brilliance. Comrade, as we know, when you look at the inner policymaking circles in Vienna, was hamstrung not only by the incompetence, of course, well, his own incompetence, but the incompetence of the military, but there was stout opposition coming from one quarter in particular. That was István, or Stefan Tisza, the Hungarian minister president. Now, since 1867, the so-called Ausgleich, or compromise, Austria had to give considerable autonomy, I mean almost full sovereignty except for common matters of foreign policy and security and so on, to Hungary. Now, Tisza did not want to go to war with Serbia. Not because he liked Serbs. He was a little bit like Franz Ferdinand. Franz Ferdinand, although he didn't like Tisza, also didn't like Serbs. But for that reason, both of them, and particularly Tisza, thought that going to war with Serbia was kind of a bad idea, because if you didn't like Serbs, why would you want more of them? They were already causing enough problems in Hungary, and Hungary was not exactly treating its minorities with kid gloves. They were persecuted rather savagely. Magyarisiert, as the Germans like to say, of the approach towards the population. They're all being kind of Hungarianized, as we might say in English. Well, so Tisza is stoutly opposed. Eventually, though, the Serbs get so crazy, both in kind of what is being said in the Serbian press and in the general response to this business, that even he finally has to go along. Unfortunately, of course, it took several weeks for this to happen. Now, during the period when Tisza was still opposed, the only way that Conrad and the foreign minister, Leopold von Berthold, thought that they could break Tisza's opposition was by getting the Germans on board. Now, this is partly because, of course, they also knew that they couldn't really do anything without German support. They knew that there was at least a possibility that Russia might intervene, whether directly or indirectly, in any Balkan conflict. They knew that Russia had always taken, to put it mildly, an interest in Balkan affairs. In fact, the Russian minister in Belgrade, Nikolai Hartwig, is often credited, if that is indeed the right word, with being the mastermind of the Balkan coalition which had teamed up to attack Turkey in 1912. Well, Hartwig, incidentally, and this is another one of those little stories that I found quite fascinating, Hartwig is said when he hears the news from Sarajevo, that is that the Archduke Ferdinand had been assassinated, he actually held a bridge party that evening. And was heard to remark, well, let's say he said several things which didn't exactly indicate undue sympathy for the Austrians. When he finally did show up about 12 days later to semi-officially condole with his Austrian counterpart, Baron von Giesel in Belgrade, things went badly rather quickly. He denied the story. There was also a story going around, which was actually true, that when they had the funeral, all of the other legations put their flags at half-mast. The Russians did not. He said, no, not true. Gross slander. And then he said, oh, and it's not true about this bridge party. You know, utter slander. My enemy spread this story. He then died of a heart attack inside the Austrian legation. What was amazing about this story, of course, was that the Serbs immediately assumed that he had been murdered by the Austrians. So incidentally did his daughter, who came in, and she started rummaging around, you know, to see if he had eaten or if he had been poisoned. And the Austrian said, no, he was here for 10 minutes. He didn't even have time to eat anything. Well, did he smoke anything? All right, yes, you know, he smoked 2 cigarettes. And so she took those and she put them in her purse, you know, as evidence. The Serbian press then had a field day, and they ended up erecting all these monuments in town to the Russian minister. Now, incidentally, just this year, I don't know if any of you guys picked up on the news wires that Serbia has actually unveiled a new statue of Gavrilo Princip, national hero. But back to the Germans. Okay, so the Germans, what are they going to say? What are they going to do? That's the big question. Tisza is beginning to kind of think, oh, well, maybe the Serbs are crazy enough, we might have to do something. But Austria is impotent, and he will never go along unless the Germans say something. Unfortunately, the Germans were not there in Vienna. Now, curiously enough, the Austrians themselves kind of made this more difficult by not inviting anyone to the funeral. Now, theoretically, the Kaiser was supposed to come, Kaiser Wilhelm II. He was, incidentally, probably the only man among Europe's royalty who actually liked Franz Ferdinand. He was a little bit of a prickly character. And for that very reason, the Kaiser was kind of an important wild card. In fact, these are the two most important things as far as the interplay of the personalities you have to remember to understand the origins of the war. The most powerful voice for, if not peace, then at the very least voice against going to war with Serbia and Vienna was the Archduke Franz Ferdinand, who was now dead. The most important voice in favor of, you know, shall we say, not allowing Austria-Hungary to go to war in the Balkans had been Kaiser Wilhelm II. In fact, he had left the Austrians out in the cold during the two Balkan wars, offering not even really rhetorical support for the Austrians when they wanted to keep Serbia from getting a port, basically on the Adriatic Sea. If we go back to the other map, I'm not sure if this clicker actually works, but if you go back to the other map, Serbia wanted a port, the Austrians didn't want to have it. The Kaiser basically said, rubbish, nonsense. He actually said that a war with Slavdom, that is with the Slavic powers, you know, on behalf of these Austrian pretensions in the Balkans would leave us quite cold, he said. The Kaiser was a strange man, and a man of many contradictions. So the trouble for the Austrians was how to basically get him in the right mood. Now, they wanted to petition him at the funeral, figuring that he would be in the full flush of rage over the murder of his friend. But then the Germans said he couldn't come. They said it was because of back pain. Privately, through back channels, they said it was because they didn't actually trust that the Austrians could keep the funeral secure from terrorism. That's actually why they didn't send the Kaiser. Because of this, the Austrians had to send a mission to Berlin, the famous Hoyos mission that everyone kind of reads about in the books, which leads to the so-called blank check. Now, interestingly, even the blank check, you know, when you get up to the German side of this, the Kaiser did not initially respond positively. He was actually initially quite cool. He warned of European complications. You know, he did not think it was a wise policy to go too far. He wanted to make sure to kind of prepare the diplomatic groundwork. The problem with the Kaiser, though, was he wasn't particularly strong. He could actually be swayed and manipulated. And that's what the ambassador did. He just kind of dropped the subject, brought it back, dropped the subject, brought it back. He didn't get far enough during lunch, and so he waited until afternoon coffee. And during the afternoon coffee, he finally got the Kaiser essentially to spill the beans and say that, you know, he would support Austria-Hungary, essentially come what may. If not exactly a blank check, it was something resembling it in the sense that he thought the Austrians should be free to formulate their own policy. The problem, both with the Kaiser and then the Chancellor, Bethmann Hollweg, who kind of signs on the next day, is that they actually thought the Austrians would do something sensible, or at the very least, forthright, decisive. Their idea seems to have been that the Austrians would actually move rather quickly with a kind of preemptive military strike, you know, possibly just a temporary occupation of Belgrade, located right as it is on the Austro-Hungarian border. However, of course, nothing happened quickly in the Austrian Empire. They have to win over Tisza. They have to wait for the officers to come back from harvest leave. By the time the Austrians even come up and formulate the plan for an ultimatum, 4 weeks have passed. They don't finalize the text until the 19th of July. And even then, interestingly, and this is one of those odd, there are all these histories that imply that there was this kind of Austro-German, you know, premeditated plan. If so, that plan was bonkers, I have to say. It was not a particularly effective or clever plan. And in fact, the Austrians did not even coordinate the terms of the ultimatum with the Germans, nor the diplomacy. In fact, when the German ambassador in Vienna asked to see the ultimatum, he was told it wasn't ready yet, even though it had already been sent to Belgrade. They lied to his face because they didn't want him to read it. Why they didn't want him to read it, I suppose you can guess when you actually read the final thing, which was, shall we say, not terribly diplomatic in its language. Now, the ultimatum itself, now, it is true, and this is actually one of the points Chris Clark makes in his book, The Sleepwalkers, which is quite a good point. You know, he says, well, everyone says this was like the most draconian ultimatum of all time. Shock, shock, shock. How could they draw up such a thing? This kind of, you know, from some kind of Paleolithic era of diplomacy. He said, you know, I actually compared it to the ultimatum that NATO sent to Milosevic before the Kosovo War. It was much less harsh. That's not to say it wasn't harsh or that the Austrians were not expecting Serbia to reject it. Of course they were. There's no mystery about that. They're quite clear about that. You can actually read literally the transcript of the council, which they held in Berthold's house in Vienna, a house amusingly called the Strudelhof, you know, the House of Strudel, where they actually hashed out these terms. They all came in, you know, unmarked cars, kind of high security and secrecy, except for the fact that Berthold, the foreign minister, had blabbed about the ultimatum to a retired diplomat who frequently had lunch with the British ambassador, who promptly told the Russian ambassador all about it. So as diplomacy, as even statesmanship, this was about as incompetent as you could possibly get. Worse was to come. The Austrians had not even done their worst yet. So they're trying to figure out, you know, when to send the ultimatum. And now originally they had wanted to send it before the French president, prime minister, and foreign minister, the latter two basically premier and foreign minister, the same person, René Viviani, arrived in St. Petersburg. But it took them so long to get their act together that by the time they're finally finalizing the terms, they're basically already at sea on their way to St. Petersburg. The reason they didn't want them to learn about it, of course, was they did not want France and Russia, close military allies going back to 1894, to be able to coordinate a military response. You know, as Berthold put it, you know, rather elegantly, it would be best if they did not get the news while they were toasting champagne, as he put it. So rather inartfully, the Austrians send off a flurry of telegrams to St. Petersburg asking when, by chance, President Poincaré and Premier Viviani will be leaving St. Petersburg. Unbeknownst to them, the Russians had broken the Austrian codes, and they were actually reading these cables. And so they actually knew that the Austrians were waiting until the president, the French president, premier, were going to leave, and then they were going to unleash the ultimatum. Now, as it turned out, they didn't actually quite wait. When they finally did deliver the ultimatum in Belgrade, Poincaré and the Tsar were actually still on board a vessel, you know, in the Gulf of Finland, toasting each other's health, although they didn't actually get the news until quite after the French president had left. But so the ultimatum to Serbia, it actually unfolds in almost uncanny parallel with this summit being held in St. Petersburg between the French president, the premier Viviani, and the Russian Tsar. Now, the French often get away with kind of what we might say a rather unskeptical press on their own role in the July crisis. Some of this is because of all the powers, the French documents seem to have gone missing the most frequently or regularly. A lot of Russian documents are missing too. Give an example of what I mean by the latter. The Russian ambassador in Paris, Izvolsky, who had actually been the Russian foreign minister at the time of the first Bosnian crisis when Austria annexed Bosnia-Herzegovina in 1908, he had been humiliated in this famous sort of hoodwinking by the Austrian then Foreign Minister Arendtl. He had been forced to resign in disgrace as consolation prize. He was given the embassy in Paris, from which post he spent the next half decade plotting his revenge. You know, it was said when he finally heard about Russian mobilization, you know, a bit like Khrushchev with the shoe, he pounded the table and said, "This is my war." Well, this is my war, man, is Volsky, possibly the most important single diplomat in the July crisis, arguably. His correspondence with Sazonov, the Russian foreign minister, goes missing for 4 weeks between the 28th of June and the 23rd and 24th of July. There are two telegrams that survive, which are talking about kind of minor domestic matters. Now, I was curious about French politics. The French premier was by no means very belligerent. In fact, quite the opposite. He was sort of a milquetoast. He was a former education minister. He was not actually supposed to be premier. The man who was supposed to be premier was Joseph Caillaux, who was really the leader of the left in France. Caillaux, however, was not allowed to become premier, even though his party had won a thumping victory in the May elections, because his wife was on trial for murder. She was on trial for murder because a newspaper editor had been publishing incriminating information about Caillaux, and she thought he was kind of not man enough to do his own fighting, and so she showed up in his office, you know, and said, "Monsieur, I'm sure you understand why I've come." And he said, "No, madame, I have no idea why you've come." And then she pulled out her pistol and pumped 6 shots into him. So she was on trial for murder literally while all of this is happening. Viviani, in fact, doesn't even want to be in St. Petersburg. You know, he's mostly trying to follow the trial because he's trying to figure it out if he's going to get to be premier for much longer. Because if there's an acquittal, it's possible, even though everyone knows she did it, there might have been an acquittal that Caillaux would take over. And so he's following that news. He doesn't really want to be there. Poincaré, on the other hand, is quite enthusiastic about this military alliance, despite the fact they had to hold their nose a little bit, you know, with Russia being an autocracy and so on. The Tsar himself had to hold his nose whenever they would play the Marseillaise, which is, you know, shall we say, a great anthem of lèse majesté. So there were problems, shall we say, in the Franco-Russian alliance. That is, problems where the Russians were always afraid if the left came to power in France, they would jettison it, because the left hated Russia. You know, Russia was the land of the knout, the pogrom. Labor, before 1905, hadn't even had the right to organize. Russia is kind of a black hole. Now, this summit, then, is designed to smooth out these problems. Now, it's almost like manna from heaven for Poincaré that this news comes that Austria is about to deliver this ultimatum to Belgrade. Had he been informed about it, Well, we have no proof that he had, until he got to St. Petersburg, when in fact he was more or less informed about it. And they began talking about this Austrian action. In fact, he literally warned the Austro-Hungarian ambassador not to do this, saying effectively, you should know that Russia has an ally in France. Which is kind of diplo speak for, we will go to war on Russia's behalf. Now, what was agreed between the French and the Russians in St. Petersburg, we don't know exactly. We do know they had a common diplomatic line, which came out immediately after the summit, which was to warn Vienna not to issue this ultimatum to Belgrade. The warning, what I call the anti-ultimatum ultimatum, actually got there a little bit too late. We do know, however, that France's ambassador backed Russia's early secret mobilization to the hilt, encouraged Russia to go even faster. There's always been a claim that he didn't have the backing of the president for this, which is kind of interesting, considering that he had no authority short of what was given him by the government in France. And in fact, he had just spent 4 days huddling with the president and the foreign minister. So France, we know that France takes a strong line ultimately, almost certainly before France took a strong line. Did that mean war was fated? Not necessarily. If you go as late in the crisis to the 28th and 29th of July, there's a rather interesting puzzle in the chronology. First of all, Austria, as we all know, Austria-Hungary declared war on Serbia on the 28th of July. The day before, Austria-Hungary had informed Germany that she would not do so until about August 12th, because the army wouldn't be ready until then. This is what Konrad had told Bertel. Not that Konrad wouldn't have liked to start the war as soon as possible, but remember, a good portion of the army is on harvest leave. So the problem the Austrians had, they got the denial from Serbia that they wanted. And incidentally, Serbia's rejection of the ultimatum was quite brilliantly spun. They actually told all the kind of the diplomats and the press right before they replied that they were going to accept the vast bulk of the ultimatum. They then proceeded to not do that in their actual reply, which rejected one clause unequivocally and kind of buttered up the other ones with language to the effect of rather than issue a public apology for the assassination and any involvement, they issued a public apology for having been accused of a crime, which is not exactly the same thing. But still, it was a rejection, which is, of course, what the Austro-Hungarians wanted. A rejection, incidentally, which was finally green-lighted when Serbia got permission from Russia. That is to say, the Russians said, no, go ahead and reject one clause and we will back you. Austria-Hungary, though, is still in kind of a difficult position. They know now that Russia might intervene. They're not quite sure what the scenario looks like. And meanwhile, their army isn't ready to march. So Konrad, oddly enough, the uber-belligerent warmonger, is the one who says, no, we should not declare war now because we're not ready to fight yet. After all, as he pointed out, in the Balkan Wars, in the Russo-Japanese War, the aggressors hadn't just gone out and said, we're about to declare war on you. They just kind of invaded. They didn't want to do the kind of rather dumb thing and put the declaration of war right out there for everyone to see, because diplomatically that made no sense. It's getting your carrots and your sticks backwards. Why declare war now and then wait 2 weeks to fight? Makes no sense. Berthold, however, and this is, I think, still not generally appreciated, just how bizarre it was that he issued this declaration of war 2 weeks before Austria-Hungary was ready to fight. There's no logical explanation. I think the explanation is actually a personal one, and this is my own take, and I cannot offer you proof, because I cannot read the mind of someone who has been dead for many decades, but I do think that Berthold essentially was sick of all of the telegrams and phone calls he was getting from everyone trying to mediate this peace, because he had already decided Austria needed a war with Serbia. And now, when the phone rang, or the cables came in, he didn't have to answer them anymore. He didn't want to answer his phone. And so he declared war on Serbia. By telegram, in French, a language which the Serbian prime minister did not know. There weren't many diplomats in Belgrade who knew the language either. In fact, Pasic, the Serbian prime minister, immediately sent off this urgent cable to Paris, London, and St. Petersburg, asking them for clarification of this strange telegram he had received, and what did it mean? It really didn't make sense. Now, we know about this date, the 28th of July, that curiously enough, the Kaiser woke up this day. And it's true that the news had been kind of like sugar-coated and he hadn't been presented with the full news yet. He had not yet read Serbia's reply to the ultimatum. He woke up this morning and he went for a staff ride with one of his adjutants. Unfortunately, he didn't read the telegram, that is a Serbian reply, until after his staff ride. Because by the time he read it, he immediately thought, oh, well, you know, even though they didn't agree to everything, this is great. You know, you don't need war now. Just basically take this as a victory. And if you need to have a symbolic occupation of Belgrade, fine. Make sure that they carry out the terms. But this is a victory. And he says, we should get this information to Vienna. But he didn't really like using the telephone. And oddly enough, he thought it was such an important message that he shouldn't send it by telegram. And so instead, he sent it by private courier. And by the time the news got there, Berthold had already declared war. Now, it's interesting that if you fast forward just one day later, you can begin to see some of the problems with this thesis of this kind of dire German premeditation, this plan, this arch plan that the Germans had, because not only had the Kaiser gotten cold feet, incidentally, his plan is watered down so much by the Chancellor, because the Chancellor is still, at least on the 28th of July, taking a harder line than the Kaiser. One day later, however, the Chancellor begins to have his own second thoughts. And the reason he got these second thoughts, and again, you have to be very precise about the chronology, because basically he had had a really long day. Everything had gone horribly wrong. He was already exhausted. He wasn't sleeping well. His wife had just died. He was miserable. You know, so it got to be about 10 o'clock at night, and he's panicking. This is on the 29th of July. He's panicking, and the Chancellor, he's basically trying to find out what Britain is going to do now that he thinks war is going to happen. He spent his entire political career and most of his capital on rapprochement with Britain. He had even offered, on one occasion, to donate Germany's high seas fleet to England, you know, as a gift. Now, as you might imagine, the naval minister was not fond of the idea, nor was the Kaiser. But he really did not want to go to war with Britain. This would be like the ultimate humiliation, reversal of everything that he stood for and believed. And so he decides to call in the British ambassador. To try to basically just feel him out to see if he can get some pledge of British neutrality, which would just allow him to sleep at night, you know, basically. Unfortunately, he wasn't quite in his right mind, and so he began, in exchange for this thing he wanted from the British ambassador, he began doling out inside information. You know, it was a little bit like an act of diplomatic striptease. The ambassador realized that he had like a live one here, so he kept reeling him in. He's like, well, so tell me about Germany's war plan. You plan to invade Holland? No, I can assure you, and this he actually could assure, because the old Schlieffenplan, they actually had been planning to go through Holland, but not in the Moltke plan. Yes, I can promise you. What about Belgium? Well, I can assure you that so long as the French don't violate Belgian neutrality, we will respect Belgian territorial integrity at the end of the war. Okay, that's not quite a confession, but it's pretty close. So unfortunately, Bethmann has now sold away the store. He's given Britain its possible casus belli by diplomatic striptease. Amazingly, he would not have done this if he had received a telegram from London before he met with the British ambassador. This was the telegram in which Sir Edward Grey, His Majesty's Foreign Secretary, who was elliptical at the best of times, and in this message, for the first time, he gave this hint that if things came to such a pass on the continent, we would be forced into taking rapid decisions. In that case, it would not do to stand aside and wait. Well, okay, again, this is Diplo speak for we might actually go to war with you. And in the language that everyone knew that Sir Edward Grey used, this was about as hard-line belligerent as you could possibly fathom. Unfortunately, however, he read this telegram after he had just confessed the darkest secret of Germany's war plan to the British ambassador. He read it at about 11 p.m., and it threw him into a panic, because now he knows that Britain will probably fight. And so what did he do? What did the German chancellor do? Faced with the ruin of all of his policies, faced with the encirclement of Germany by three great powers, he dashed off a telegram to Vienna, to his ambassador in Vienna, ordering him to force the Austrians to negotiate. He rescinded the blank check at about 2 or 3 a.m., on the night of 29-30 July 1914. Unfortunately for Bethmann, Austria-Hungary had begun shelling Belgrade about 10 hours prior to this. So it came about a half a day too late. Now, just to shift the focus back to France and Russia for a moment, it's interesting what's happening there on the same night, 29th of July. This is a fascinating thing. Again, not much as I love her, Barbara Tuchman is not always infallible. In her book, there's a great dramatic scene, you know, where Germany gives this ultimatum to France. By now, we're on Friday, July 31st. You know, they basically, the Russians come and they have to wake up Poincaré and Viviani, middle of the night. You know, good God, these Russians, they're worse insomniacs than they are drinkers. You know, what will France do? Will you support us? Great scene, classic Barbara Tuchman. But she's 2 days off. Didn't happen on Friday. Happened on Wednesday. The reason the scene happened on Wednesday is because earlier that evening, after, as I've just reminded you, Austria-Hungary began shelling Belgrade, the news arrives in St. Petersburg, the foreign minister Zonov gets the Tsar to agree to general mobilization. Now, admittedly, the Russians didn't want to advertise this right away, and as it turned out, it was a bit premature, because about an hour after he received this, basically this order, the head of the mobilization division was called back to the phone, and the Tsar changed his mind. Now, interestingly, the Tsar changed his mind because he got a telegram from the Kaiser, the so-called Willy-Nicky correspondence. What's great about this is that he thought the Kaiser was responding to a telegram he had just sent about an hour previously. But in fact, it didn't work that quickly. The Kaiser was actually responding to a telegram he had sent the night before. And so he was actually kind of moved on false pretenses, if you will, but moved to call off the dogs of war, rescind the general mobilization orders. However, in the process of making this move, this decision to move towards general mobilization, back when they thought it was going to happen, Sazonov sent a message to the ambassador in Paris, Izvolsky, essentially saying that due to our inability to accede to Germany's desire that we cease mobilizing, we must now regard war as imminent. This on the 29th of July, the same night that the German chancellor is attempting to rescind the blank check. Russia has resolved on war, and she has involved France, or at the very least informed France in no uncertain terms that this is true. It appears that the decision had already been made. It is true that the Tsar was still wavering. And I mean, one of the sadder parts of this story is that despite the bad press that monarchy gets these days, while none of the monarchs in the end made any decisive move to call off the dogs of war, in fact, to the extent that several of them were involved, they did try. The Kaiser, as we have seen, actually did try to get the Austrians to back down. The Tsar himself was consistently badgered. And here's the oddest part of the story. It's usually said that they were badgered by the generals, and you often hear this kind of blanket condemnation of the generals and their war plans and the timetables. But in both Austria-Hungary and in Russia, it was the foreign minister who made the running and the key decisions. In fact, the Tsar, as he's getting badgered the next day, because now Russia doesn't want to lose time, and they are desperate for the Tsar to basically rescind his rescinding of the order for general mobilization, so desperate that Yanushkevich quite famously says, next time I get the order, I'm going to go smash my telephone, he says. I'm not going to allow the Tsar to back down this time. The Tsar refuses to see any of the generals. The only man he will see is Sazonov, because Sazonov had always had a reputation for being more reasonable, for being a kind of man of moderation. He was expecting and hoping that Sazonov would give him an out. Instead, Sazonov convinced him that there was no alternative and that he had to order general mobilization. Now, I mean, we know from the drama of the scenes, from some of the phrasing, you know, I do not want to be responsible for a monstrous slaughter. People talk about this short war illusion and did they have any idea what they were getting into? Well, no, they didn't know what would happen. They didn't know that the war would last for 4 years and embroil much of the globe. Of course, they didn't know those kinds of things. But they knew they were playing with fire. The Tsar knew perfectly well that the order for general mobilization would make war unavoidable. The Germans had told him such. He knew this. So did Sazonov. They were all agreed and decided. The rest was essentially just mise en scène. The French, you know, artfully kind of putting together this plausible deniability. You know, when the final order for general mobilization comes through, Paléologue, the ambassador, mysteriously takes 30 hours to report the news to Paris. You know, the messenger got lost on the way to the telegraph station, right? And so the French continue to maintain, you know, for many years afterwards, that in fact Austria-Hungary had ordered general mobilization before Russia, entirely untrue. You know, there are many aspects of the story that were massaged and manipulated. You know, the powers obviously began kind of purging the documents and so on. But in the end, unfortunately, the story comes down to this. The war party won out. It won out in Vienna. It obviously won out in Berlin. Won out in St. Petersburg. It won out in Paris. The only remaining question, as of really the 30th of July, was who would win the kind of arranging of the diplomatic mise-en-scene to get Britain to either come in or stay out. I don't actually have my time. How much time do I have left? Do I have time for Britain?
2 minutes.
2 minutes. Britain to come in or stay out. Well, this is obviously a much larger topic than we covered in 2 minutes. But briefly, a couple of interesting points. Sir Edward Grey is best remembered, I think, in this entire story for his remark that, you know, the lamps are going out all over Europe. We shall not see this again in our lifetime. It's not always appreciated that part of the reason he was probably saying and thinking this thought is that he was actually losing his eyesight this summer. He was not paying particularly close attention to events. The coalition was fragile. Grey, certainly Churchill, definitely Asquith, the prime minister, were definitely on board with the kind of Francophile policy, that is, these ongoing military conversations with France. However, most of this policy, even most of the knowledge of it, had been concealed from the cabinet. Even a naval agreement by which Britain and France had agreed that basically France would cover the Mediterranean, Britain would cover the coast, had not been revealed to everyone. In the end, the paradox is that partly because so many of the liberals, and this was a cabinet of the liberals, were actually opposed to the war, a few of them stood up and a few of them resigned. However, a lot of them went along because they were afraid, I think, in my reading of the situation, that if the cabinet fell, then the Conservative and Unionist Party would take over and they were more belligerent. So then in the end, the decision came down to contingency. Obviously, the German violation of Belgium was probably the deciding factor for at least some members of the cabinet. But even so, it was quite a close-run thing. And as late as Grey's speech to the Commons, the most curious thing of all is that he did not mention anywhere in that speech on August 3rd that he was about to send an ultimatum to Berlin. It was vaguely implied, I suppose, in the speech that Britain was going to take a stand, something to do with Belgium, but the Germans had not yet violated Belgium when he made the speech, nor had he made it clear what the speech was actually about. Churchill asked him, you know, what do we do now? And he says, well, we send an ultimatum to Germany, which is quite interesting because he hadn't told that to the Commons. So there was a lot on the British side that was both confusing, contingent. In the end, I think the decision to go to war on the British side is one of the most interesting, and perhaps we could leave that for questions. If there's time for questions, is there time for questions, Laura?
There may be time for one question.
Oh, my apologies.
If
there's no
there
clock
is
here.
One. I'm also going to let you know that, unfortunately, Sean is going to be heading out today as well. So I know that there are going to be more than one question. So think on that, and we've got a break coming up shortly. Feel free to ask him those questions during
the break.
And during lunch. I would also highly suggest that you head to the museum store where you can pick up all of the books, many of the books of our speakers. Some of these speakers have many books. I'm not sure that we have all of them, but go grab a book if you'd like him to sign it as well. Was there one brief question? I see one hand that went up. And if, as we head into Q&A section in our symposium today, we do need to get them on the microphone. And I know some of you may not be comfortable with it. I'm happy to repeat them if need be. But if you'll notice, we do have some recordings going on, and we would like to be sure to catch those. Dr. Parsons.
It seems to me the war would have been avoidable if Austria had been willing to make any compromise whatsoever. And they didn't. They didn't even talk about making a compromise. They were going to invade Serbia.
Well, I think your point is right. I think the Austrians were obviously unwilling to compromise. Berthold did not want to compromise. The Germans, in the end, maybe a little bit too late, tried to get the Austrians to compromise. Had they done so earlier, that is, had they withdrawn their blank support somewhat earlier, I think it would have been possible. Now, I will say, though, that's not being entirely fair in the sense that their demands on Serbia, while perhaps slightly more, shall we say, onerous than they might have been. Certainly were not entirely unjustified. Serbia could also have agreed to those terms, at least made more of a show of clearly agreeing. And the Russians, of course, also could have convinced the Serbians not to agree. I mean, I think in the end you're absolutely right about the Austrians, but you could simply flip it around and say that's also true had the Serbians essentially agreed to the terms, or at least agreed in more diplomatic language, or had the Serbians not been given blanket, I suppose, support by the Russians. But you're right, you absolutely have to point to Vienna and Austria-Hungary. You cannot understand the outbreak of the war. That is kind of where the real story starts. I agree with that.
All right, if you will please join me in a round of applause for Dr. McMeekin.